Good evening, and welcome to the Town Council meeting number 11 of the '95-'96 year. May we have the roll call by the town clerk?
Chairman Cogsall?
Here.
Counselor Chapel?
Here.
Counselor Jordan? Counselor Linnell?
Here.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor McLaughlin?
Here.
And Counselor Reed?
Here.
Would you join us for the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
It's time for citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda. Are there any citizens that wish to come forward? There being none, we'll move on to reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman?
Counselor Chapel?
You probably saw the articles recently in the Portland Press Herald about recycling and the paper going from $125 down to $23 a ton. So it's probably a good thing it happened because it's kind of woken certain people up. And we have a new committee formed at Regional Waste that Scott Seaver, our chairman, formed within the last week. We had our first meeting last Tuesday night, and we're meeting all day this Thursday, starting at 8 o'clock in the morning, to see if we can check over revenue approaches, how we're going to go about it, not for 1 year and keep us out of trouble, but for 10 years. And so we can get an even rate for all towns for our tipping fees. We hope with the projects that we have in mind and the way that we're going to do it that we can bring the tipping fees down so there'll be no need of flow control. And it's possible to work that way because we can't see that flow control is going to do us too much good now if it is passed by the Congress. They waited too long down there in Washington, God bless them. We got to make sure that our rates and our waste flow stability for all the towns. And the biggest thing we have that bothers us is the small towns. And we don't want it to get to be a campaign of the large towns against the small towns because they have the capabilities of doing so much more with commercial waste than we do. It's a good committee. I just want to read it quickly to you so you can see what's working for you at Regional Waste. I think they're pretty well covered the area of the 31 towns. Scott Seaver, our chairman of Regional Waste, is the chairman of this committee. Bob Ganley, the city manager of Portland, is on the committee. Jerry Bryant, the city manager of South Portland, is on the committee. Dwayne Klein, the business manager of Portland, is on it. Jim Sewell from South Portland, Morris St. Clair from Lyman, Dale Olmsted, the town manager of Freeport, Glenn Frater, the town manager of Wyndham, Gary Laferno, and myself are the 10 people on the committee. I think it'll be much easier to work with the 10 and get into depth on things, which is almost impossible to do at a board meeting with 31 members around the table and battering back and forth. So we're going to try to bring one, two, or three good solutions to the board for a final vote, we hope, in early spring. Thank you.
Very good. Anyone else have a report? Counselor McLaughlin?
Thank you, Madam Chairman. Actually, I have three reports. The Greater Portland Council of Governments Executive Committee met a couple of weeks ago. Neither Mr. McGovern nor I were able to attend that. I'm the delegate and he's the alternate. But I did talk with John Bubier, the director of COG, today. And one thing that they are doing is setting up a committee to explore options relating to joint purchases, trying to find a way to do away with some of the fees that they charge right now for joint service help. And I think that's hopefully going to result in some continued savings for this town. Another thing COG is exploring is what is listed right now as a chat and chowder series, which would be a brown bag lunch series on issues of importance and interest to the county. I think it was the day after the last council meeting, or sometime shortly thereafter, Councilor McGinty and Mr. McGovern and I went to Falmouth to meet with the town manager there and have a discussion with him about their budget process in Falmouth, and came away, quite frankly, not with as many good ideas as I was looking for, but I find it very useful to understand and get a handle on how some of the other local communities are handling their budget process, and we did come back with some good ideas that we will share at an appropriate time. Also, last week, Counselor Jordan and I sat down with the manager. We are the two counselors shepherding through the council goal of improving the budget process and presentation, and had what I thought was a very good 7:30 a.m. session, and we'll be presenting to the council some of those ideas that we came up with in that session, hopefully at a workshop next month when we talk about budget process. I think we had a good meeting of the minds, and basically came down to a continued emphasis that we're going to relate the budget to council policies. That was the bottom line that I finally could articulate pretty well after that session. And a couple of weeks ago, I went to the National League of Cities Leadership Training Seminars that they have prior to their end of November, early December convention. I've put before the counselors at their places a quick, almost a soundbite, of some of the highlights that I came away with from three of the seminars that I attended. Those were seminars relating to customer service, which is a continuing council goal, coalition building, and extraordinary performance. I find it very interesting, this kind of training session, where you go to sessions with different topics, with different focus, that there are some repeated themes throughout. Some of the repeated themes that I tried not to get too redundant with on this sheet for you was the need to deal with people's perceptions, not always with the reality, but with people's perceptions. And I think as elected officials, we're pretty well aware of that, and we do that on a very regular basis. Again and again, I heard that local government needs to focus on customers, and local government needs to focus on outcomes. We do a lot of process work, and you have to do that. Your process work has to be tied to outcomes and some good, strong, clear policies. As a municipal official in my day job, I found it very interesting to hear another repeated theme was empowerment of the workforce. And I hope that is something that we can continue. We've got the staff in the audience probably saying, yeah, yeah. And I don't know what the staff up here is saying about that. But as that was emphasized so often, so many different ways, and I hope it's something that we can focus on as a council as well. But very informative sessions. I'm just sorry we couldn't have more councilors there to bring back more information, because I certainly couldn't get to all the sessions that I wanted to. Very rewarding.
Thank you. Any other reports? If not, I would like to extend to the U.S. Coast Guard the thanks from the town of Cape Elizabeth for the installation of the light from the Two Lights Lighthouse that's now in our lobby for all to view. Also, those of you who were not able to attend the open house of the middle school, Pond Cove Schools, yesterday, it was a very uplifting, positive experience. The children were so proud of their schools. I was met at the door by two students, Jacob Metzger and Patrick Doughty, who gave me a tour of the building, and their pride and their knowledge about the building just filled the hallways. I must say that I've been on many guided tours, and this rates right at the top of them all. Also, the students had written letters to the taxpayers, and you saw this theme throughout the school. It was a great cross-section of citizens from Cape Elizabeth, parents with children in the schools, parents without children any longer in the schools, senior citizens, single parent people. And it was a theme that they were aware that taxpayers have made a big sacrifice to give them this wonderful facility. I also want to thank the Cape Elizabeth Fire Department for the calendars that they gave, the pocket calendars they gave the counselors. We look forward to it each year, and they're very helpful. We also have available a publication that has just been produced on the Thomas Jordan Trust. Some copies are available in the manager's office. We're about to have another printing made, and they're there upon request. And the Cape Elizabeth Volunteer Fire Department has a flyer That's about recruiting an informational view book of the fire department, engine one, engine two, rescue, the wet team, and the fire police. Now we'll move on to the minutes of meeting number nine and meetings number 10. There is an amendment I would like to propose on item number 70 for meeting number nine. The vote was a 6-1 instead of a 7-0. Are there any additions or corrections to the other minutes? Councillor McLaughlin.
I believe in item number 65 on that same meeting, I believe that was also a 6-1 vote.
Is that the right one? Or the wrong one? It was 65 and not 70. Okay, that's the one it should be.
Oh.
Too many pages.
Oh, okay.
Any other amendments or corrections? If not, I'll take a motion.
We approve.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor? 7-0. Now we'll hold the public hearing on the open space impact fees and the proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance. I'll turn the meeting over to Ordinance Chairman John McGinty, who will give us the information before we have the actual public hearing.
Thank you, Madam Chair. This is a change to the subdivision ordinance section 16-3-1 sub Q regarding open space impact fee. And what it does, it updates the ordinance, brings it more up to date, brings it in line with decisions and changes that were made by the U.S. Supreme Court and in state law. And essentially, it required us to conduct an inventory of the open space lands we have now in the town and to require developers to donate space in proportion to that or through a financial formula be able to contribute a fee to a recreation fund that must be used to provide open space for recreational purposes. It's essentially a reformatting and an updating of the open space ordinance.
Thank you. Is there anyone from the public who wishes to come forward to make a comment? There being none, I'll close the public hearing and we'll move on to item number 74 to consider proposed amendments to the subdivision ordinance relating to the open space impact fee.
Move approval.
Is there a second?
Second.
Discussion? Councilor McLaughlin.
In the cover sheet, and it was the current cover sheet, an older one, there's a memorandum dated September 20th, 1995, and it makes reference to the development of a recreation plan. The ordinance committee is supporting that. What can you tell me about that?
That maybe is not exactly correct. What we wanted to look at was what the, not a plan itself, but to look at what we believe the recreational needs to be, what they currently are in the town, and what they will be in the future. And in that regard, I've asked the town planner to provide us with some information on recreational needs based on population and size of towns. From professional organizations. So we're not looking directly at a recreational plan per se, but to just look at where we stand and where we might want to go.
And I'm wondering how, if at all, that ties in with the council goal of looking at fields. If it's Italian or not.
I
think it's appropriate that they might be.
I think there definitely could be, yes.
Have you received that information yet?
Yes, and I don't know if it was, might ask the town manager, if it was distributed to all the councilors or only to the ordinance committee.
I think it was to the ordinance committee.
Just to the ordinance committee.
Just to the ordinance committee.
We'll make it available to all the councilors, particularly ones on that subcommittee.
Thank you. Thank you. Any discussion?
Just, on that, thank you. On that point, the council's having a workshop sometime in January on fields. Maybe it'd be appropriate
to include that material along with some other material at the same time as part of a larger packet.
27th.
On the 27th of January. Thank you.
There being no other comments, those in favor of the motion? Those opposed? 7-0 in favor. Item number 75, to consider approving the annual liquor licenses for Susan T. Leg Events Incorporated for the Inn by the Sea and take any necessary action. Ms. Lane?
Thank you. In your council packet, you did receive an application from Susan T. Leg Events. This is a renewal application. As our ordinance indicates, the town manager, chief of police, fire chief, and code enforcement officer were given this application prior to council action for their review. They did not come back with any comments to the contrary of this application being accepted this evening. Ms. Leg is here tonight if you have any questions for her, and I would recommend that you do approve the application.
Any comments? If not, I'll make a motion, please.
Move approval.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 7-0.
We can just correct something. I think the manager, I just heard the manager say we were having a workshop on January 27th. It's a Saturday. I'm not going to...
Whatever that Monday is of that week.
Is it the 22nd? Did I hear 27th?
We can talk about that after.
Well, I think the public should know. That's why I'm making a show of it right now.
I'm going to go check my notes.
The 22nd is a Monday, and the 29th is a Monday. I didn't know.
We've got two different workshops, so we've got to see which one's on which date.
We do have different workshops. I don't have it on here.
I'll go look.
Thank you.
He has the schedule set pretty much for next year. Meanwhile, we'll move on to item number 76, to consider an update report from the Local Americans with Disability Act, ADA Committee. And I believe Gail Parker, who is the chairman of the committee, is here to update us.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You all got a copy of our just overall report, and I wanted to give you an opportunity to ask any questions about that and also to review it for the benefit of anybody listening or anyone in the audience. FACE 2000 is the new acronym that we're using, which stands for a fully accessible Cape Elizabeth by the year 2000. And that's a lot simpler to understand and to recognize and remember than the ADA 504 Accessibility Advisory Committee for the Town of Cape Elizabeth. And it also fits on envelopes and things a lot easier, not to mention posters. The ADA 504 Committee is required by the American with Disabilities Act, and it's to keep the towns in compliance with the law. It's getting a little bit complicated, but that's the bad news. The good news is we're making huge progress. We've made tremendous progress already in the Town of Cape Elizabeth, and we're off to a great start and have, I think, a really tremendous opportunity facing us. For the last couple of years, since the ADA Committee first was formed, most of the time has been spent kind of putting out brush fires, kind of crisis management, a little bit like what you were faced with the school buildings for so long, looking at a problem and saying, okay, we've got to fix this right now. With the new school buildings and the new elevators and the new ramps here in Town Hall, a lot of those immediate crises are passed. So now we have to look at the broader meaning of the law. The law expects towns, governments, public accommodations such as stores and businesses and hotels and things like that, to provide services to all people with or without disabilities. That implies to employment practices and service practices. You are required to have accessible facilities, programs, and services. So it's a lot more than everyone's first impression, which is wheelchair ramps and elevators, and maybe a sign language interpreter here and a Braille sign there. The committee has worked very hard to try and think creatively and look at the big picture. And one of the favorite examples that I use is our wonderful Great Pond Nature Trail. Now, that's a fabulous place. It is not and never will be physically accessible to all people with disabilities. It would provide not only an undue hardship to make it, but it would break the ruling of the law in that it would substantially change the basic nature of a nature trail if you were to put ramps and handrails and paved walkways. So you have to stop and say, all right, the law still expects us to make the benefits of that trail available to people with disabilities. So the kind of thing that the committee has tried to do is sit back and say, okay, we can't take them there. How do we get, what are the benefits of the Great Pond Trail? So the solution that we're working on is to come up with a videotape of the Great Pond Trail, narrated, done over several different seasons, and to have that available at the town library. Thereby, people who can't physically go along the Great Pond Trail will still have access to some of the benefits and services of that wonderful experience. One of the nice things about that example is it shows that the benefits of the Americans with Disabilities Act go far beyond just people with disabilities. If you have company coming and it's a rainy, icky, mucky day, which of course we never have in Cape Elizabeth, it would be nice to be able to go to the town library and take out the video and let them see it, whether they have or have not got a disability. A lot of the things with the American with Disabilities Act provide tremendous benefits for the population as a whole, whether they are permanently disabled, temporarily disabled, or blessed with being fully abled. The opportunity that we have is to make Cape Elizabeth a fully accessible community. By law, we are obligated to do that for people, whether they are citizens of Cape Elizabeth or whether they are here for just one day. Our goal is going to be to work in three areas. We want to improve access to programs and facilities. That's the most commonly thought of part of ADA. The second is to increase awareness and understanding. That's basically getting the information out, letting people know that no, we don't require every single building to have an elevator. No, you don't have to have a sign language interpreter present at all of your town council meetings. But you have to have a plan so that if somebody calls up and says on their TDD or sends a message to you saying, I would like to speak at the next town council meeting, I have an issue, you need to have a plan for finding an interpreter and getting them there for that meeting, because they have a right to that. And it's not that hard if you're working, as our committee is trying to, proactively, ahead of the crisis, and have plans in place and procedures so that it's very simple. The third part is developing and maintaining resources. And I have to say, this is very exciting, because all across the country, towns are dealing with this. I have become connected with several organizations, one of which is the National Organization on Disabilities, their community partnership program, of which we are now a member, I'm proud to say. I have also become involved on the internet with a list of ADA coordinators. And what's nice about that is I just recently put a posting out and received a response back from the town of Belchertown, Mass., and from the town of Irving, California, or Irvine, or whatever, California, giving me samples of the little notice that they have come up with to put in stores, in small stores that just, there's no way they could provide full access. But what is the language and the wording that they have found successful, legal, and useful, not to mention understandable, that they could just put a sign up at the front door saying, if you need assistance, this is how you do it. What's the smallest number of words that one can do that in to fit at the bottom of a town report? Now, I brought with me tonight some large print copies of this report. It seemed appropriate as the ADA chairperson to do that. Do you have to provide those? No, but one of our biggest partners in this can be our town library. Everyone in this community, whether they are a full-time resident or a one-day visitor, has access to the town library. Limited access, I grant you, depending on when the hours are open, but they have access. So if we have things available in the town library, we have met the criteria of ADA in terms of making them available. So we are working, for example, to make a single copy of Cape Courier, which is perhaps the most vital communication tool in this community, short of the grapevine, and to have a large print edition of the Cape Courier and an audio tape version of the Courier available in the town library. I would suggest to the town council that a copy of their agenda be made in large print available in the town library. With computers, it's very easy. You just highlight select all and you increase the size, and it takes about 2 minutes to print it up maximum. We're working very hard on this. You may have read some Cape Courier articles. We are now having a column regularly in the Courier with common questions and answers about ADA. We are meeting in the conference room the second Wednesday of every month, and that is open to everyone. We have a school group which is working to put together a CETV program that will highlight some of those things. A flyer went out, which you have a copy of, about training and awareness programs, and we have already had one group, the Cape Lions, who have scheduled a presentation for February 20th, so that's off and running. The questionnaires that you have there are what we would propose to go around to different community groups, businesses, divisions, whatever, and that's again pulled from the recommendations of ADA coordinators all over the country who have responded to my questions. Putting it together and keeping a record of it, this becomes a part of our plan, which we must keep on file, and our self-evaluation, which we do have to update periodically. The needs assessment gets a little tricky. By law, we can't keep a list of people with disabilities. So probably we will be putting something like that in the Courier sometime and hoping that people will respond. We need to be able to prioritize where we need to spend our money first. Money is limited. Money will always be limited. So is time. We have to find out what we can accomplish that will benefit the most, the fastest, the easiest, and the most reasonably. And as I've been on this committee for several years, it occurred to me that we had never once, to my knowledge, made a direct report to you folks, except through Phyllis and Bill and people who have been there. And that just didn't seem right. So we're here tonight. I'm here representing the committee. I'll be at the school board meeting doing much the same thing tomorrow night. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them.
Councilor McGinty.
Thank you. I brought my copy of the Courier because I was impressed with the article that you put in there. You obviously have a good grasp of the issue. And I think increasing awareness is the way to do it, through the Courier, through public presentations, obviously. Later in the agenda, we're going to be transferring some money into a fund to improve access to the town hall. And I wanted to ask you if you had had any input into improving access to the town hall by the use of that money.
At this point, have I?
Yes.
At this point, it hasn't been brought to us yet.
Is that something, if we asked you for some non-binding recommendations, is that something your committee might want to offer, some recommendations?
We'd love to. I mean, we certainly were very pleased to say. It's never been officially brought. We certainly made it known that, for example, you folks needed an elevator. It was
right.
No big surprise to anybody. But we would be happy to be a part of that, as we would with any town project.
Great. Thank you.
Councilor.
One of those days.
Just promoting you.
Yeah, what Councilor McGinty was talking about is taking the back door and making it level, mm-hmm. going out there. And then, remember, you looked at those plans. It was quite some time ago now.
Oh, back when we were talking about the school. Yes, I have seen those.
It was the committee did see it, but it's been a while.
Any other questions? Councilor McLaughlin.
If you could just tell us some of the other members of the committee, I think that would be helpful for people listening tonight to know how widespread this is.
It's a kind of a rotating committee. Phyllis comes all the time as representing the town council. Nancy Hutton is there as one of the administrators, and we always invite the other administrators as well. We have Sue Weatherby, who comes frequently. Scott Poulin has asked to come on a regular basis. We shifted last year and restructured it. There used to be a list of about 10 people, maybe three or four of whom were parents who were directly involved. And what we've tried to do in the last 6 months, and Phyllis can help me out if I misrepresent this, but we've tried to make it a little bit more flexible and say, all right, let's have a pool of people, and when we're going to be discussing the Cape Courier, we'll have the Cape Courier people come, but they don't need to necessarily attend every meeting, because people are meetings to death. In January, we're discussing how we can bring volunteers from the community into that. So at that point, Gail will be there. And Sue Weatherby comes if we're going to be talking about building issues or about community services. Janet comes instead if we're talking about connecting with the seniors in the community. We pull that direction.
Great.
Counselor Reed?
Thank you, Gail. I have a comment instead of a question, and that is, please don't overlook the use of Channel 3 for that Great Pond Adventure, because some people who are almost able-bodied may enjoy that as well.
Absolutely. That's one of the benefits. I appreciate that.
Very good, Gail. You've made a lot of progress this past year, and it looks like you have a definite plan of attack for the future.
Thank you.
Move on to item number 76, to consider the update of report on the ADA. Have a motion, please.
I move that we accept and file the report.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 77, to consider a report from the Appointments Committee regarding annual appointments to boards, commissions, and committees. And Mr. McGovern, you have that date for work.
Yes, thank you.
I can tell you're wiggling your pen.
Yeah, the council's having two workshops in January. One is on January 22nd. The major feature of that, we'll be discussing ball fields in Cape Elizabeth Fields. On the 29th, you'll be having a workshop as well. That will be a preliminary discussion of the budget, as well as some other topics, but it'll be predominantly a budget discussion. In addition, the councilors are all invited to a orientation meeting on January 4th for boards and commissions, and the January 8th council meeting. It's a busy month.
Thank you for clarification.
And I'll turn this item over to Chairman of the Appointments Committee, Counselor Linnell.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. We have a number of new appointments that, which I'd like to tell you about, and if we approve these, I'm pleased to announce that we'll fill, at least temporarily, every spot on the boards and commissions will be full. So first of all, to Area Development Council, and I guess I'd like to make this in the form of a motion, so that I won't have to read the names again. Does that sound? Sounds right?
Fine.
Okay. To Area Development Council, a reappointment for one-year term, Gregory Cross. To the Board of Assessment Review, Ann Kerner, a reappointment. To the Arts Commission, Dee Lee Rich, a reappointment. And Virginia Hansen, filling a spot that was formerly held by Jane Roberts. This is her first term. Virginia has a background as an arts curator, and she just, speak for myself, that she was smart as a whip and had a lot of energy. And so we're pleased to appoint her to recommend her to be on the Arts Commission. On the Cable Television Advisory Commission, Dick Murray for a reappointment. Helen Damon, also to Cable Television. She is new. This is a new appointment. She has a background in product development. She's very well-traveled, particularly very familiar with French and Japanese cultures, and very creative. And also to Cable Television, Ann Ridge, filling a spot vacated by Madeline Anguera. Ann Ridge would be a new appointment. She brings, would bring a lot of enthusiasm and a historical perspective of the town of Cape Elizabeth to that slot. To Community Services Advisory Commission, Karen Dunphy. Karen Dunphy was on Family Fun Day Committee for, I think, 6 years, did a great job, and she was looking to, for a change, and was very enthusiastic about being on Community Services. Also, Mike Alfiero is, this is a new appointment. He's self-employed and has a coaching background. To Conservation Commission, Bob Harrison is a research scientist and very outdoors-oriented. That's a new appointment. Andy Hall. Now, Andy Hall is a student at Cape High School. He's a junior. And something we're doing for the first time, where it's an experiment, I suppose, we have three Cape Elizabeth High School students that we are nominating for positions on boards and commissions. And we talked about the idea. We talked to the principal, Rick DeFusco at the high school, and we have three candidates, Andy for Conservation Commission, and two that I'll get to for Family Fun Day, and we're just really pleased that the level of maturity and capability, what we see is a tremendous amount of capability from these students, and in fact, we need them. It helps us fill the spots, and we're very optimistic about what they can contribute to the town. Gary Punsky, also to Conservation Commission. He is not a student. he's replacing Jim Bevel. And Gary was formerly helped us out on the former Sewer Advisory Commission. Bill Robidoux, filling a spot left by Greg Toot. Bill Robidoux had served us very well in the Cable Television Advisory Commission, and it was our former appointments chair, Councilor McLaughlin, who in our discussion talked to him, raised the question, well, you know, how's it going? And he said, well, you know, it's okay. And she said, but what would you really like to do? And he said, well, I'd really like to be on Conservation Commission. So we robbing Peter to pay Paul, and we took him away from Cable TV. And we'd like to nominate him for Conservation Commission. Also on Conservation Commission, we are nominating Don Evans. He's an attorney who has outdoor interests, and I'll try to speed this up a little. Family Fun Day, Karen Price would be a reappointment. Betsy Colburn is new. A new nomination. She is a claims processor at Blue Cross Blue Shield, and she expressed an interest in Family Fun Day at Family Fun Day when I was there last summer, and so we've roped her into this position. And the other two spots open on Family Fun Day, we hope to fill with the other two students from the high school. Rachel Potter is a junior. She contributes to the student service project at Cape High School, and Emily Scotton, a sophomore, and she has volunteered, she's a sophomore, and she's volunteered at Christmas dinner for the homeless people and a senior citizens dance, and I was just very impressed with their, how much they had on the ball and their maturity and willingness to contribute. For Fort Williams Advisory Commission, Joseph Groff to fill a spot left by Randall Weil. Also, Pierrette Lawler. Pierrette, it would be a reappointment. And Personnel Appeals Board, Joe Groff is doing double duty. That's a reappointment, however. He's an attorney, manages the office, and we feel that since we don't expect too many, or we hope that we won't have too many personnel appeals, we think that he can juggle that and his position on Fort Williams Advisory Commission. To the planning board, we would reappoint Peter Carter and Mark Wilcox. Recycling Committee, Mandy Garmy and Martha Palmer would be reappointed. To the Riverside Cemetery Trustees, we would nominate Jane Jordan. Jane Jordan has a tremendous perspective on the town and at what perhaps can be a dry subject up at the Riverside Cemetery. Jane has a rare sense of humor. To the Thomas Memorial Library Trustees, we reappoint Dr. Joe Schenkel, we reappoint Patricia Twitchell, and a new appointee is Ann Swift Kayada. Ann Swift Kayada has one of the most impressive resumes I've ever seen, and I think she will do a great job there. To the Zoning Board of Appeals, Glenn Bickford is a reappointment. Amory Houghton, a reappointment. Also to the Zoning Board of Appeals, Jerry Petroselli. Jerry served us, did, I think, just a fantastic job helping us on the Thomas Jordan Trust, and we asked him to consider the Zoning Board of Appeals, and he will. And also on the Zoning Board of Appeals, Joe Frustacci. Joe is a developer and will lend an very interesting perspective to the Zoning Board of Appeals, and he would fill a spot left by Rob Smith. Rob is an airline pilot and just it can't be, well, his job takes him away quite a lot. Finally, Fair Hearing Officer, we reappoint John Amerling. And those are the nominations.
Second.
Very good. That's a fantastic job. It's not always easy to fill so many spots at one time. If there is no, no discussion, we'll move on. Yes.
We need a second.
We did have a second.
Excuse me.
I would just like to add something, briefly. I'd just like to thank the other councilors on the Appointments Committee, Councilors Reed and McLaughlin. It went very well, and we're pleased that at this point every position is full, and Councilor Reed knows everyone in town, and was instrumental in filling these positions. Councilor McLaughlin is the former chair of this committee a couple of times, and knows everything about appointments and about the various boards and commissions, and so I would just like to publicly thank them very much for all their efforts.
You know, I'm a...
Thank you, Madam Chair.
All those in favor of the appointments? Opposed? 7-0. Next, we move on to item number 78, to consider establishing a committee to be known as the Cape Elizabeth School Service Delivery Study Committee and take any necessary action. This, the development of this committee is a result of the Town Delivery Service Option Committee, which was about 3 or 4 years ago. And it was one of their recommendations that the same approach be used for the school services. And in having two meetings with the school board chairman, it was determined that the manager and the superintendent would put together the charge and the establishment of this committee. And I believe the school board is going to be adopting this approach at the same, possibly tomorrow night at their meeting. The establishment. There is hereby established the Cape Elizabeth School Service Delivery Study Committee. The committee shall consist of 7 citizens jointly appointed by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council and the Cape Elizabeth School Board. Citizens wishing to serve shall apply to the Town Council Appointments Committee. The Appointments Committee shall be joined by the two school board members in screening and recruiting applicants to serve, and shall recommend a slate of nominees who shall reflect the diversity of the full committee, community. We're hoping that that will also include interested senior citizens. The purpose of the committee is charged with reviewing all services necessary to support the educational mission of the community. This excludes classroom teaching, special education, and guidance, but it does include such areas as transportation, food service, facilities management, purchasing, accounts payable, payroll, clerical assistance, and financial management. The committee shall also review areas in which there might be improved collaboration between the municipal and school departments in all service areas. The committee charge is 1. The committee shall undertake the reviews outlined above under committee purpose. 2. The committee shall present a preliminary report to the school board no later than October 1, 1996. The school board may comment upon the report prior to a final report being prepared. 3. The committee shall present a final report to the town council and school board no later than December 31, 1996. Mr. McGovern.
If I might, I did receive a call from one counselor about this, actually several, since it went out, Rosemary and Phyllis. Under the purpose of the committee, where it says transportation, food service, facilities management, the copy, it's my intent, the copy that the council, that the committee gets of this, will actually have all those bulleted, just so that they can follow them better. That was a styling recommendation that Rosemary made, as well as to move facilities management to the top, since that is such a major piece. Again, Rosemary had suggested that of what's going on, and Phyllis had suggested to add to the end of the establishment, including interested senior citizens, as she just read.
Councilor Reed.
I have another suggestion for consideration. First of all, Councilor Glenell, we just need new appointees, so let's not brag that we fill everything, because then we turn around on the next item and get another responsible. What I'd like to add, if appropriate, is that the superintendent of schools and the business manager be named non-voting ex officio members. That's consistent with what the municipal service option delivery committee had with the town manager and department heads.
Comments from councilors? Councilor McGinty.
No, I would just like to concur with what Councilor Reed said, that I believe those people should be part of that committee, or ex officio members.
I would concur with that. I just written down my question was, who's going to staff this? I know it's always a concern we have a municipal committee. I, quite frankly, don't think we need to add the fact that we're going to be looking at senior citizens. It says we're going to reflect the diversity of the full community. And if we start singling out one group, I think we better start singling out a whole bunch of other groups.
So essentially the amendment to add ex officio would be the superintendent and the financial officer?
Business manager?
Business manager.
Mm-hmm. As non-voting, ex officio.
Right. Just non-voting.
And as a particular group, it was the idea of including senior citizens was just to include them to apply for this seat. There is not going to be one particular position that is designated a senior citizen. It's just that sometimes when it's the title deals with schools, senior citizens often feel that they're not, wouldn't be considered for a position or not considered as influential. But we would like to have interested, qualified senior citizens to feel comfortable to apply.
And anybody else who doesn't have children in the system?
Yeah. True.
Yes.
But we could have
we'll
gone
go for
on
full
on
diversity.
On. Right. Comments? Motion. Councilor Reed.
I'll move acceptance of the Cape Elizabeth School Service Delivery Study Committee charge with amendment of the...
Second. Discussion? Counsel Lanelle.
Yeah, I'd just like to mention that in terms of this facilities management, I hope they do take a good, hard look at that, and as a footnote, that a lot of people I've talked to in town have said, you know, one of the reasons we got into, we're spending $11 million for this beautiful school that we've just cut the ribbon at, is because we didn't take good enough care of the buildings we had, and so I'm hoping that this committee may consider the possibility of the capital planning and maintenance of the schools to come under one person, which would be under the municipal side, and I think that would prevent this from happening again. And I've talked to a lot of people in town, and everyone I've talked to supported it. I think there's some support from on the school board. The superintendent promised to kiss me if this happens, so I think anyway, I hope they do this. Thank you.
So you're working hard to make it happen, is that correct?
Amen.
Any other comments on the motion? If not, all those in favor? It's a 7-0.
Couldn't pass it up.
Just in case people are wondering, there is a lot of concern and interest over the pool. We have had a feasibility study done, and we, in conversations with the school board, plan to set up a separate committee to study the pool. It thinks it needs in-depth study. It wouldn't be dealt with thoroughly in this type of a format. So that will be coming up beginning of next year. Item number 79, to consider a request from the Recycling Committee to place a recycling bin at Cape Variety and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, Cape Variety, for those that get confused with all the similar sounding names, is the store once known as Rudy's. Had another name in the middle there, too. It's across from St. Bartholomew's Church. The Recycling Committee for a number of months has been looking at different sites for possible placement of a recycling bin. They looked at the old entrance to Fort Williams Park, felt that was inappropriate in a park setting and in an area that wasn't fairly closely watched, and as well as concern with the carry-in, carry-out policy that it might be used for purposes other than intended. They looked at the parking lot at St. Albans Church. There were some real issues there involving the movement of the recycling bins in and out. We looked down by the Little League field there, had the same problem, but the pump station had the same problem. Anyway, they are still looking possibly at placing an additional bin, and they've recommended Cape Variety. The earlier proposals didn't come to you because they just didn't seem to be able to even be worked operationally. This one is coming before you, even though the staff is not specifically endorsing it, simply because it doesn't have the same operational problems as the other sites. I did receive a phone call, and I believe some counselors may have as well, from the citizen who most immediately abuts this area, expressing strong concern with the placement of the bin at this particular site. Councilor Chappell mentioned earlier of the point, and I think that the newspaper article did as well, that was that this morning?
Sunday.
That, you know, we do need to really be encouraging recycling. It is a cost avoidance of $85 a ton, but, you know, I think there is a very legitimate issue as to whether or not this is the appropriate location.
Councilor Reed.
Madam Chairman, if the town of Cape Elizabeth were divided into districts, where I currently reside would be in this district. I've talked to several people who all wonder why it needs to be put so close to a residential neighborhood. And my personal feeling at this point, having sat and watched the traffic go in and out of this site, that there potentially could be problems with traffic and confusion because of curb cuts, the intersection of Church, the Broad Cove Road, and also the beginning of a bend on Route 77, and though I'm not an engineer, I'm a driver, and I think that there's enough activity going on in that area right now without adding additional traffic, and I cannot vote to support this evening.
Counsel McLaughlin?
Madam Chairman, I'm going to follow up on that. I'd heard from Mr. McGovern today that there was a strong concern from the immediate abutter. I did get around to talking with one person on the recycling committee and asked if they had contacted the abutters, and I was told no, they hadn't. I was not able to get in touch with the chairman of the recycling committee. And I know there are other abutters there who probably would want to know that something like this was going to happen in a basically residential area. I'm going to move that we table any action on this until we can have some more thorough information from the recycling committee about the impact on the abutters.
So is that a motion?
That's a motion.
Second.
All those in favor of tabling? Those opposed? 6-1. So we table this until it's brought forward. When we have sufficient information, Mr. McGovern, could you give us some idea when that might be possible?
I can't speak for the recycling committee, but as I understand the tabling motion, it was to suggest that they have some contact with the abutters, so
right.
I will let them know that suggestion occurred. And I would like to mention we did send notice of this item out to all of the immediate abutters. But the recycling committee had not specifically discussed it with them.
I'd like them to have those conversations.
I'd like to see that expanded, maybe besides the immediate abutters, because there probably are very few of those, but in the general neighborhoods around there. The same reason.
Do it 500 foot.
Councilor Jordan.
So I guess the table motion is allowed to discuss further on the issue.
We've already voted.
That's it. We've directed them to notify the abutters and have discussions and conversations with them and get back to us with the information. And then we'll have it brought back before us again.
Okay.
Number 80, to consider a report on the applicability of geographic information systems for Cape Elizabeth and take any necessary action. I believe we have present Jerry Daigle, who is the town assessor and the head of the department, and with him is Maureen O'Mara, our town planner, who's doing the research on this project.
Good evening. I was asked, Jerry and I are going to try to do a very brief few minutes presentation to try to explain to you again what GIS is in case you haven't read enough about it or seen enough about it so far. But what we've done here is we're referring to this project as CGIS, which stands for the Cape Elizabeth Geographic Information System. What is GIS? GIS is the ability to do computerized mapping and spatial analysis at the same time. What will it do for the town? I heard Councilor McLaughlin talk about outcomes, and the outcome of this is that it will do two major things for the town. First, it will allow us to complete tasks that we currently do in a much faster and more efficient and effective way. And the best example of that is the number of notices that we send out currently and the amount of time we spend generating the names of abutters. This program will make that happen in a space of a few minutes. Secondly, what it will do, and what I see as the more important thing, is that it will allow the town, it will give the town the ability to do analysis and review data that backs up and promotes sound policy making. And that's something that you don't have as a tool right now when you're debating and making policy decisions. Unfortunately, GIS is best explained in a visual format, and we don't have a big computer to show you how we can do it. So what we tried to do is pretend that this is your computer screen, a large rectangular computer screen. And you're going to look at the GIS system. And the first thing you pull up is your parcel map. And overlaid on that is your zoning map. And This isn't anything new, it's something that most towns have. It's a garden variety map, it's in black and white. There's no way to do any analysis of how much of the town is in each zone, and if there's any subdivision or land, or any new development that creates a new road, you're going to have to draw it onto this map. And in addition to drawing it onto this map, you're going to have to draw it onto every other map the town has that refers to parcels and lots and roads. So there's a duplication of effort. But if this was your GIS screen, you could click a button, and you could automatically get something in color. And what color does for you is that it automatically makes it able, you able to see things and do some analysis. You can tell that most of the town is in the RA zone, because that's yellow. But you still can't do much in terms of database analysis. You don't know exactly how many parcels are in the RA zone. If you asked the computer, please tell me which parcels, give me the addresses and the names of people who own property in this BA zone down here, you'd have to go to the assessor's chart and have to write it down one by one. But GIS will give you that information right away. But how does this information, the zoning information, these parcels relate to other things in town? Where are these parcels related to fire hydrants, for example? The example we're using is the sewer service area, because that was easy to draw. And if you had a coverage in the computer, you could click on another icon, and immediately would pop up, overlaid onto your zoning map in color, where your sewer service areas are. And you can see here right away that most of your RC zone, which is orange, is served by public sewer. So these are some of the things that the GIS will do for you in a matter of seconds. Most of the costs that we see, the investment town makes, is in building these maps in the computer. But once you have them, you can relate this information to different things. And what I've tried to do is tell you what GIS does for analysis on a town-wide basis. And Jerry's just going to take a few minutes to tell you what it does on a more specific basis.
Thank you, Mark.
Madam Chairman, members of the council.
Yes.
What we have here is again a screen, and if I were to require the information I'm going to produce on this next layer, it would take the office staff or myself at least 20 minutes. Now, what I've done is clicked on to the screen the picture of the house or the building that we use. You all know where this is. It's a Sprague Hall in the corner of 77 and Fowler Road. Below it would be, on the same screen, the building data, which would be the owner, the value, location, and other information. Also would be shown the appraisal, what the value of that particular building happens to be. Up here on the right-hand quadrant would be the deed. The reference for the transfer of that particular property would also show up on this screen. Now remember, it took one click on the mouse or the return key for those of us that don't have the mouse. On the bottom right-hand corner would be the data on the land. This lot, which is located, I think what happened here is I forgot to pinpoint. This lot is, where'd it go?
Great Pond. All over.
This would also show up the lot size, its exact location, and any other information that you would require as far as zoning. This information would also be scanned in. We have the potential for scanning the documents in. Not too sure how that would proceed as to which scanning equipment we would use, but that would be an important part of this entire feature. The beauty of this is that all of this information, once loaded in, would be at our fingertips. It would be also customer-friendly. We could provide this for those people who come in and ask for this kind of information on a daily basis. It also would make us more efficient, because we could call up this information. It would take you 20 minutes to go looking for these different parts in the office, all coming up on a 21-inch screen. And that, in a nutshell, is what GIS can do for us. And we can answer any questions that the council may have.
Thank you.
You have any questions? Counselor McGinty.
Yes. I noticed that you, you indicated in the report here that this has town-wide application to virtually every department. I guess it is every department in the town. Have they been involved in the planning process at all? Have you been meeting with these people to ensure that they have input so that, I mean, we develop a system that will include everybody from the beginning?
At this point, we have concentrated on a very small nucleus, myself and the planner, Maureen. The reason for this, it's more expedient for us to go out and pull the data together that we feel ought to be involved as far as the hardware, location of the equipment, if you will. What we are doing now, and we began this last week with a meeting of the department heads, is to start pulling in what I call the larger circle, and they'll be networking to these various departments. We'll be meeting with these various departments to find what their needs are, because if they can't network and pull this data out as quickly as I can for the information, for instance, roads would be important for public works, hydrants for fire, et cetera, et cetera. Yes, that is something that we are now beginning to explore. When we purchased the hardware, we would have known what each department needs are.
Does your budget include networking with departments?
Some of the layers will already be included in this. For instance, I think the sewer layer is the first one I could think of, possibly the hydrant layer. There'll be instant networking, but I must add that when we get into the specialties of each department, then there probably will be a budget item that would be requested beyond the simple layers such as sewer and hydrants.
We had a discussion about that this past week. The budget does not include a network server, so that the information is readily accessible at the offices. Initially, within this budget, they would need to physically contact through one means or another the assessing codes office.
My major concern is that 3 years down the road, when Bob wants to use this for public works, that suddenly he finds he can't get connected to it, or that the programs, the software that he needs, won't run on this machine or whatever. I just want to ensure that from the beginning we include everybody, so that down the road, everybody can get connected.
Yeah. There are lots of other communities that are already using the software in a network-type environment. But what we're talking about right now is setting up one standalone system. We've already heard from the manager, and we will be pursuing when we select exactly which hardware that we purchase, that there are opportunities for other departments to network into that. But they will probably have to be buying their own computer hardware to run GIS from their station, because it requires a lot of memory. But we're going to make sure that whatever we do doesn't preclude anything.
Other questions? Councilor Jordan.
Yes, does this proposal we have before us something that has to be done in 1 year, or as this budget goes here? Phase one, two, and three?
Yeah, the budget, Councilor Jordan, is proposed to be done during the next 12 months, the first phase, which is a $40,000 phase. That's all with existing appropriated funds that's being proposed to be allocated to this specific project. Beyond that, the cost would come in succeeding years' budgets and would be spread out. If you look at the line graph that Maureen prepared, it shows how the cost spread out over a number of years. And in addition, there will be annual costs to the town, and I'm not sure if it was mentioned in the memo, but as developers subdivide land, right now they put their subdivisions and their plans on CAD systems, or computer-aided design systems. When subdivisions are approved, we will ask them to give us a disk of the subdivision, so that we can immediately transfer it into the system. I would like to mention, too, in terms of the applicability of this system and how it fits in, is that it's proposed that we purchase a system of software called ArcView. ArcView is the predominant operating system for GIS in the world. So it's the software that we would be purchasing is not something that's not in common use.
One more. Excuse me.
No, you still have the floor.
My other question, I understand I read the budget, but I thought it should get out over the air a little bit of what is going to happen down the road. My next question is this a labor-saving device?
Yes, very much so.
So you don't have to hire any more help?
We'd be able to work with the system in-house with the existing staff.
Good. Thank you.
Councilor Reed, did you have a question?
I had a question and a comment. I'll give the comment first. That from members of the public who think this might be a large outlay, we've already seen a very detailed presentation, and we have been shown graphically what the system can do long-term and short-run for the town, and I think it's a wonderful opportunity. My question is, are these training amounts adequate based on what has to go forward in light of the fact that the two of you have already been involved in learning how to do this so far? I just think that the training amount appears low.
What we found is that there's a lot of opportunities for a lot of free training out there right now, and I suspect as GIS becomes more common in use, there may be someone who decides it's profitable to start running actual training sessions. But right now, it looks like there's a lot of opportunity to learn about the system. There's a users group. We've already been given a demo copy of the software that we don't really play with too often because it doesn't run on our computers very well because they don't have enough memory. But there's a lot of people out there that are becoming familiar with this and are willing to share their information. So, you know, I'm comfortable with the training amount right now. Obviously, you know, if we had a problem, we'd come back to you and we'd talk about it. But right now, it seems adequate.
The other concern I have is about cross-training and about public works, fire and police, when they do need it, you know, coming into the picture 2 years after the fact and maybe missing a lot of the beginning stages. And I would just want them involved to the extent they should be in learning how the system goes so that when they have the capability, they have the knowledge.
ArcView is something that can be learned very easily if you've had some computer training of some kind. It's something you can walk through. If you've seen it applied once or twice, I think you'd be anxious to get hands-on. And it's fairly easy to work as long as your equipment, your hardware is good with the memory, as long as it has adequate memory.
That workshop meeting was powerful. As a person who understands technology but doesn't understand planning per se, I just thought it was very easy to understand and most helpful.
Somewhat unrelated point, but want to relate to the council. During the last 4 or 5 months, I believe, at every meeting of our department heads, as well as at every meeting of our personal advisory committee, which consists of representatives from each department, we have always had on the agenda the topic of technology. And this is one example, and you know, the earlier point about empowering employees, empowering the staff, this is one example of doing that where Jerry and Maureen have really taken off working on this, working with other departments. Today's meeting, the Personnel Advisory Committee, we had a lengthy discussion on global position satellites, GPS systems, you know, whereby, you know, during an ice storm, we could locate a catch basin, which sometimes we can't find at these points. And, you know, it's just endless, and we've done quite a bit of brainstorming at how technology can better serve the customers, the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. And one of the issues that came up at the Personnel Committee today was, well, have you done the same brainstorming with the town council? And they really encouraged me to work with the council to have you do a similar exercise. And,
answer was no.
The answer was sort of no, but you know, I would hope that perhaps at a future workshop we could really have a good discussion on technology and the direction we're going. But this is a major advance and something that, you know, 3 years from now, I think, you know, we will be seen as a community in the leadership of it and continuing to evolve it. But at the same time, it's going to be very commonplace, and just about every community is going to have this because the market out there that uses this information is going to be expecting us to have it. And this tonight, I think, if you approve this, will be a good start. Let me talk a little bit about, while I have the floor, about the money and where it's coming from.
The initial $40,000 is coming from four sources. One is some monies that were carried forward from last year's budget, $15,974. That is money that the Planning Board had left over from special studies, as well as some Conservation Commission funding. This year, the Planning Board, Tom Emery, the chairman of it, is here, allocated their full amount for studies, $10,000, toward this, hoping that you would approve this. And the Planning Board's taken a very active interest at a workshop presentation we had last Friday morning. Tom Emery took time out from work to attend it, as well as Steve Etzel. And other, at your workshop, other members as well attended. And they strongly support this to the tune of investing and hoping to invest, with your authorization, their full allocation of study money this year. Third, Casco Bay Estuary Project. The Casco Bay Plan has really put together a lot of base information on GIS, and they've offered us, in addition to all of their records, which are going to be crucially important in their disk, they've also offered us a direct cash grant of $2,000 to help us get started, as well as an overall, the final $12,026 is from an overall computer upgrades account that meets all these needs throughout the town. So that equals a total of $40,000, all previously appropriated funds, but none of the funds specifically allocated for this purpose, except for the carry forward balance that was done as of June 30.
Janet, did you have a comment?
He said it all. I was making my notes, and he was saying it as I was writing it down. The employee empowerment I talked about, but I'm going to say it again. Customer service, which is becoming so important. And I think if we're expecting the applicants for subdivisions to do something for us, then this is something we can do for them as well. I like this because it's becoming interdepartmental, and I like it because it's using technology to serve the customers. It's a wonderful combination of so many things that we need to be focusing on. And as a planner, I was really excited to see the presentation they did with us in workshop. I think it needs to be emphasized again that the Planning Board was at that workshop and Conservation Commission folks, and they're all really excited about this. If I were on the Ordinance Committee or the Planning Board, I would certainly be excited about having this kind of information when I have to do some ordinance work, so I can understand why they're ponying up their $10,000 for it. And I think we're probably in order for a motion at this point. And I would move that we approve that we authorize the expenditure of $40,000 as presented in our memorandum from the manager from the four accounts as specified, and that they go through for the phase one as presented to us in the memo this evening.
Second motion.
Discussion? Councilor Reed.
I'd just like to know about the timing of phase two and phase three, please.
The phase one is going to begin tomorrow. Sorry, it's actually already begun, although we haven't spent any money.
I thought yesterday.
And phase one will be continuing through to approximately the end of 1996. You will be asked for funds for phase two in the fiscal year budget coming up July 1, with an eye towards spending those funds during the latter part of that fiscal year. Phase three is just $6,400, and that will be an ongoing part of continuing budgets. And it's expected, you know, that there'll be a continuing maintenance cost for this. Ink is very expensive. The color printers, we were talking about that earlier before the meeting, in relation to just one little sheet. And you do those big, huge maps, and you run into some expensive maintenance equipment. It's going to be about $5,000 a year. We will have some offsetting income through sales of maps as well as sales of information.
Any other comments? Council Linnell.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. The Spray Corporation essentially has this kind of capability, and since I used to live down that way, I'm familiar with it. And if it hasn't already paid for itself, I'm sure it will before long, in terms of their ability to manage the property there. And so, I've seen. Had some exposure to what it's done for them, and it's been extremely worthwhile for the Spray Corporation. And it would seem that the town should have at least that capability.
All those in favor? 7-0, none opposed. Congratulations, you can call. On to item number 81. To consider a recommendation from the code enforcement officer to schedule a public hearing on January 8, 1996 on the possible condemnation of 537 Shore Road and take any necessary action. Are you Michael or is Jerry going to?
I'll do it and then Jerry will be here in case there's detailed questions. First of all, I would like to disclose that the owners of the property, James and Meredith Burgess, are longtime friends from college when I was at Orono. I do want to make everyone aware of that, that I have known them for a long time. Nonetheless, I am recommending, and Ernie as well, that you set a public hearing on your January meeting on the possible condemnation of their property on Shore Road. This is across from the Cookie Jar, the former Basics building. The fire there was July 6th. Ernie has worked with them consistently since then, as well as the fire chief, encouraging them to keep the building boarded up, to continue along with the planning for it. And he has been given a lot of promises since July 6th. They have boarded up at different times, but it's really been lacking in terms of execution of getting anything done, as you can see. The building is felt to be a hazard. Mr. Burgess did take out a building permit that the application was received on November 27th. Ernie did issue a building permit on December 1st to improve the building. However, we have great concern based on our past experience on whether or not the work will actually be done. He did give them 30 days to get some good positive movement on the building permit, and my concern was that at the time, you know, if nothing was done in the next 30 days, that if we didn't set a public hearing now for January, it would be the February meeting of the town council before you could address it. My sincere hope is that the issue will be resolved prior to January 8th meeting, but nonetheless, I do think it's important to create pressure on the property owner, as well as protect the public safety, that you have a public hearing on the possible condemnation at your January 8th meeting.
Councilor McGinty.
Mike, has there been any recent contact with you?
We sent them a notice of this meeting, and I think the last discussion Ernie had with them was around the beginning of the month. But we haven't heard from them in the last 11 days.
Councilor Reed.
Michael, do we know, and is it appropriate to ask if the insurance settlement has been made?
I don't think that is appropriate. We usually don't ask questions like that. It is a matter of public record that the property is on the market, has been advertised in the Maine Sunday Telegram, perhaps in the Press Herald. I usually insurances and those type things. That's people's private business. I don't comment.
Thank you.
Is there a motion on this item? Councilor McGinty.
I move that we set a public hearing for Monday, January 8th, 1996 at 7:30 p.m. at Town Hall, a declaration of a nuisance condition from unsafe structure at 537 Shore Road.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? Opposed? 7-0. Item number 82, to consider a proposed policy for drug and alcohol testing for personnel in safety-sensitive positions with commercial driver's licenses and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. This affects Public Works employees who have commercial driver's licenses, virtually all of our Public Works employees, with the exception of our clerk. This comes about as a result of a federal law, Title 49, CFR, Parts 391 and 394, which came about as a result of some rather bad accidents involving subway trains as well as Amtrak trains and abuse of drugs and alcohol. The substance abuse policy, which is before you, has been reviewed by Bob with the employees in Public Works. They are fully aware of it. Again, it was also discussed at the Personnel Committee both last month and this month. It was noted again that the hearing was occurring on it. This is a fairly standard boilerplate policy. It was developed predominantly based on a policy from the city of Lewiston that I've heard highly praised by independent sources at different workshops I've been on this. The way the testing will work is we'll be contracting as providing the policy with a third-party administrator, an outfit called Occupational Rehab and something. They're in the town of Scarborough out at Southborough, and we'll be part of a pool along with the towns of Scarborough, a number of other communities, our own school department and other school departments. And what they'll do at this place is essentially have drawings by computer of who has to come in. I will be, in our case, since Bob is subject to it and I'm not, I'll be the person who gets the name of the person who has to get brought in for testing. They won't know about it in advance. We will call and schedule a time. It'll be a matter of going over and getting the employee and letting them know they have so many hours to go over and have the test. They'll have to do it. If they don't, the penalties are provided for in the policy. This will be incorporated, if adopted, into part of our personnel code. There is an expense for it. It's expected to run several thousand dollars a year for the testing. It is a mandate that must be followed. In conclusion, I would like to just mention two things. One is to thank Bob for all of his work preparing the policy, as well as I think he's probably attended 6 workshops and seminars over the last couple of years on it, spent quite a bit of time on it. And also want to particularly thank as well the town of Scarborough, Pamela Fogg in particular, who's their personnel director, human resources director, who has really organized a consortium of towns to work together on this. She's has scheduled training that's going to be taking place next week. Rob supervises in it and has really been helpful. So I think it's a really good example of communities working together to save funds as well as trying to meet a federal mandate.
Thank you, Mr. McGovern. This would include, I believe you said in your cover memo, it does not include our fire department drivers because they are not required to have commercial licenses?
No. They're under the federal law. They're volunteer firefighters are exempted.
And would we be considering the school department, or is that a separate vote for bus drivers?
The school department is having a separate policy, very similar to this, but the school board will be acting on a separate policy.
Other questions? If not, may I have a motion, please?
Councilman I have one Jordan. Question. Why doesn't the school board and have the bus drivers get in on the same? They will have a different policy of some sort, or what?
No, the policy that they've prepared is exactly modeled on this one. It's just simply that policies within the school side have to be approved by the school board, policies in the municipal side by the council, but Scott Poulin's worked very, very closely with Bob and has taken this document, I think, put it in the word processor and changed town to school, and those things that we tend to do. We've worked very closely on it, but the council is not empowered to adopt policies affecting school employees under Maine law. Done by the school board.
We have a motion, please. Councilor Linnell.
I move that we adopt the draft policy.
Second. Further discussion? All in favor? Opposed?
I voted yes.
7-0.
You can't see my hand.
It didn't turn faster. Item number 83.
Yeah.
To consider a proposal from the town manager regarding the use of investment earnings from the 1994 bond and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. Under the arbitrage rules of the United States government, so it's odd. Usually, it's very seldom we deal with U.S. government regulations here at the town council level, but two items in a row, very unusual. Anyway,
when communities borrow money, the bond council prepares a real thick document, about 2 inches thick, that lists all the things you can do, you cannot do. They are to ensure the tax-exempt status of the bond, so that the bond holders don't later on get stuck paying income taxes. But anyway, one of the many rules on that is that any of the earnings you have from an investment of bond proceeds must be spent within 24 months of the borrowing date for essentially the original purposes of the bond, and that's been spelled out. This has been totally reviewed by our bond council at PS Atwood in terms of its acceptability. This is the borrowing that was done for the school project as well as for the Thomas Jordan Trust and for different ADA work both here at the Town Hall and at the Thomas Morey Library. The total amount in investment earnings, thanks to Scott Poulin's good work and quite frankly a very sharp pencil from People's Heritage Bank, well, other banks bid on it, they had the sharpest pencil, has equaled approximately, or will equal approximately $356,000. Earlier, the council had authorized $204,000 to build the basketball court, the community parking lot, the storage building for the bus material, and for the culvert project that was part of the town center stormwater drainage project down on the school grounds. There's a balance of $151,453, which must be expended by August 1, 1996. The council reviewed this extensively at a workshop sometime last month, and the specific proposals that are being made are, one, to keep this in conformance with the arbitrage rules of the federal government, and two, very much to follow the spirit of the vote that happened that was for the largest part of this on the school project, and that was to take care of maintenance, not to let things get behind, and, you know, to make sure that the town doesn't end up with a bigger bill later on. Specifically, what the recommendation is with the $151,000, to first reimburse the general fund, project fund, $115,000 and $115,061 for ADA improvements undertaken at the Town Hall and the Thomas Morey Library. This includes ramps and elevators and those types of things, the ramp you see behind us. Second, to reimburse the land acquisition fund $36,392. This is part of the amount that was taken from the land acquisition fund, I believe it was a total of $70,000, to purchase the Thomas Jordan land. So it's also in keeping with that piece of it. That would be the first, is to reimburse the general fund and reimburse the land acquisition fund. Then with the funds that reimbursed in the general fund, to do three things. One is to authorize the repair of the Engine 1 station roof at an expense of $4,800. The chief tells me that it's desperately needed, and he was having an Engine 1 meeting downstairs, and he said he might bring the troops up to let us know the importance of that. But the ladies and gentlemen down at Engine 1 really have done an awful lot of work. They have volunteer work, and they'd really love to see it not be destroyed by a leaky roof. Certainly, leaky roofs is in keeping with the intent of the school project and everything else. Two, to authorize an additional $30,000 from the general fund to the town hall walkway account to make the walkway entrance, this one out here, accessible and for other exterior safety improvements. We've had a number of citizens climbing up the little steps up here. They're uneven, trip. We've received letters from two attorneys over the last 2 years about concerns with some of the walkways out here. There's also out front, you might have noticed, it's in tough shape at different spots. And unfortunately, concrete work is extremely expensive. Three, we have a public works truck that's behind in its replacement because of, you know, essentially the need to keep taxes down the last couple of years while we're doing the school project. It's a 1979 truck. You received a memo from Bob Malley, Director of Public Works, indicating all of the maintenance costs that we've had to devote to that truck, altogether $32,000. The cost of the truck, the plow equipment, and the rest of it, the radio, it equals a total of $75,000.
$100. Finally, to utilize the remaining balance of $5,161 for miscellaneous repairs at the Thompson Memorial Library. This includes getting rid of carpenter ants, replacing the steps and porch at the front of the children's section of the library, and some emergency lighting and emergency exit signs and ground fault interrupters, GFIs.
Counselor McGinty.
I have a motion. I move that the investment earnings from project funds of $151,453 be used to, one, reimburse the general fund for $115,061 for ADA improvements undertaken at the Town Hall and at the Thomas Memorial Library. The two, reimburse the land acquisition fund $36,392. And from the general funds, $115,061, authorize the repair of Engine 1 station roof at the expense of $4,800. To authorize $75,100 for the replacement of the 1979 plow dump truck. To utilize remaining $5,161 for miscellaneous repairs at the Thomas Memorial Library. And to authorize an additional $30,000 to the Town Hall walkway account to make the walkway entrance accessible and for other exterior safety improvements, with the stipulation the funds not be used prior to April 1st, 1996, and that the Town Council receive unbinding recommendations from the Phase 2000 Committee on ways they would use that money to improve access to the Town Hall and to other town locations.
Clarification?
Yes.
Does your time frame stipulation apply only to the Town Hall walkway account?
Yes.
And everything else can be done?
Everything else can be done tomorrow.
Another clarification. On the $30,000, which part of the ADA bond was specifically for Town Hall and Library, and now you're extending the use of that to other buildings?
No.
He said other ADA access in other areas.
My understanding is that that fund can be used for other safety improvements. It doesn't have to be necessarily ADA. However, I would like to see recommendations from the ADA committee on how they would expend that money to improve access as a first priority to Town Hall and then to other programs, buildings in the town.
Does that meet the letter of the bond requirements?
Yes.
To extend it to other buildings?
Yes, it does, because of the fact that we have, the way we've handled the reimbursement first to the general fund, the way the motion is established.
Okay.
So in essence, by doing that, the first action, it freed up all of those funds to be used essentially how the council wishes.
Is there a second?
I'll second that with a comment.
I would just want to make sure that our clerk has your amended motion. You want to read back that?
I didn't amend my motion.
The amended proposal.
You had the summary of the proposal, then under number 4, which talked about the additional $30,000, you had the stipulation that the Town Hall walkways were not to begin prior to April 1st, 1996, and that you wanted a non-binding recommendation from the Phase 2000 committee to improve access at Town Hall, to look at that first, and then other programs and buildings, and how they would utilize those funds?
Yes, and it's only the $30,000, not the, there's apparently another $15,000 in the work, the walkway fund. If they can do work with that on the stairs or whatever, that's fine. I'm only concerned about this $30,000.
Okay, is it clear?
Just if I might, we weren't planning to do anything until the spring anyway because of wintertime conditions. And, you know, the committee earlier saw the plans and
well, my major concern is
to review it with them as well.
They re-review them, update whatever recommendations they have. That's all.
Councilor Reed, you were about to make a comment after your second.
Yes, I'd like to second the motion and say that in light of the fact that Phase 2000 report was received tonight and the presentation specifically stated as their primary goal to improve access to programs and facilities, I think this is a perfect opportunity to get that input. Also, that the townwide committee is charged with developing and providing resources and guidance for enabling the town and school buildings, personnel, and programs to comply fully with the ADA. I think that helps us to work within certain parameters that work with a standing committee, and I think it's appropriate when we can to incorporate those people. So that's why I think that's an excellent idea. I'm glad it was on the agenda tonight. I probably wouldn't have thought of it.
Council McLaughlin.
Thank you. I hope one thing that will be looked at very seriously is the front step, the wooden front steps of the town hall. I'm somewhat agile, but I became almost airborne one morning on those steps. As usual, I was rushing in to drop something off, and they were very icy, and I was almost in the fire station before I was done. Also, I want to address one other component of the motion, and that is about the 1979 plow dump truck. I think it's very important for the public to be aware of the age of this truck. It's a 1979 truck. We have already put over $32,000 of repairs into this truck, including labor hours and parts replacements, over $32,000 into this truck. That's more than it cost us in the first place. And that we are taking the existing wing plow from that truck and put it on another truck. So we are being very cost conscious about this. I just get concerned about some of the comments we hear from the public and the rumblings and the mutterings. We're being very cost conscious, and please be aware of that. Thank you.
Other comments? If not, all those in... Council Linnell.
Well, I just want to acknowledge I see the Fix the Roof lobby in the chambers here, and I'm going to support this. Thank you.
All those in favor? Opposed? 7-0 in favor. We have a new roof and a new plow truck. On to item number, where are we?
84.
Number 84. To consider setting a public hearing on January 8th, 1996, on a proposed adjustment to the sewer rates and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, the town council for the last 6 months or so has been looking at the possibility of adjusting the sewer rates to ease the burden some, particularly for folks on fixed income. What the proposal before you this evening does is reduce the minimum fee from $31 to $26.50 per month, a reduction of $4.50 per month. However, to make up for that, to increase the incremental fee from $3 to $3.82. Also to do away with the sewer availability charge that's been in place for the last 10 years, and to freeze the connection fee for those that have not been paying that fee at $2,700, and for those that have been paying that fee at $850. That's essentially the recommendation, and recommend you schedule a public hearing next month.
Isn't there also a deadline after which any credit expires?
Yes, this proposal, as I mentioned, is a differential of $850 and $2,700 for those that have paid the availability fee and those that haven't. I'm recommending that 10 years from this coming January 1 or on the year 2006, that we eliminate whatever differential is in place at that time. In other words, putting the folks on notice who haven't yet hooked up to the Southern Cape Sewer and have had it available to them since 1986, that by that point they will have had it available to them for 20 years. And that seems like a reasonable amount of time within which that they might have considered connection, considering also that many of their septic systems on January 1 of 86 were already 5, 10, 15 years old. So I think I'm glad you raised the issue. It's a very important component of this, and one that we'll try to get knowledge of spread far and wide throughout the community.
Is there a motion? Councilor Jordan.
Well, I just want to point out, for somebody that might be listening and what have you, reduced it from 31 to 2650, that's right, and that is the same 100 cubic feet. But the next step is that it's $382 against $3 for any additional 100 cubic feet, and I just feel the people should be aware of that and understand it, the ones that are listening. Thank you. I'll make a motion that we approve the fee schedule.
We're setting it for a public hearing?
Excuse me, for the public hearing. Fee schedule for a public hearing on January 8th.
8/1996, 7:30, right? There's a second. Discussion. All in favor? It's a 7-0 for public hearing in January. To consider, number 85, to consider approving the use of Fort Williams Park for Family Fun Day for June 15th, 1996, with a rain date of June 16, 1996. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, this is a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission based on a request from the Family Fun Day Committee.
Second? Discussion? All those in favor? It's a 7-0. Item number 86. Item number 86, to consider annual appointments of the assessor, building inspector, local plumbing inspector, and deputy health officers, and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, I recommend you confirm the appointment of Gerald E. Daigle as assessor. To continue until 12/31/96, perhaps thereafter. Also, as code enforcement officer, building inspector, and local plumbing inspector. Also, Ernest W. McVane Jr. For the same term as code enforcement officer, building inspector, and LPI, local plumbing inspector.
And are they both deputy health officers, too?
They both have that title, yes.
Okay.
So moved.
Second.
Discussion? All in favor? 7-0. Item number 87, to consider the acceptance of various gifts and take any necessary action. Mr. McGovern?
Yes, Deborah Lane once a year prepares the list of everyone who's been good to the town of Cape Elizabeth during the previous year. And as you can see from this list, there are a tremendous number of folks who do a lot of good things for the community, for the library, for the fire department, for the police department, the cemetery, the Spurwink Church Fund, and the Museum of Portland Headlight. In, I think, every instance, with the exception of the Museum of Portland Headlight contributions, none of these funds have been solicited. They're all people just stepping forward, sending checks in, or cash in some instances. In fact, the Employee Recognition Fund, that last contribution listed under the police department, was a cash contribution. So people aren't doing this for tax deduction purposes because they want to do something. I would like to mention the Employee Recognition Fund in the police department goes towards a number of different purposes, minor equipment, as well as for the some of the awards that go to the police department during the year. They're not monetary awards, they're plaques and that type of thing.
Motion? Councilor McGinty?
I'd move acceptance of the gifts and also issue a thank you to all the people who contributed.
Second.
Discussion? Councilor Jordan?
Does everyone receive a thank you note from
yes,
the town of Cape Elizabeth?
Or the appropriate
department? Yeah, or from the Museum of Portland Headlight.
Okay.
All in favor? That's a 7-0. I would like to have a motion made to take an item out of order, an item which was not included actually on the agenda. It's for the council to approve the warrants for the month of December, which we need to do regularly. May I have a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
For a second. All in favor? Mr. McGovern?
Thank you. I have a thing about these warrants. It must be why I forgot to put it on the agenda. These are the warrants from the time of your November meeting to this day. Would also like to mention that Senator Amaro was successful at having a bill introduced into the legislature, be a hearing scheduled, and at some point, I'm attending a meeting tomorrow afternoon at the Maine Municipal Association with other municipal officials who are interested in this bill to discuss strategy for persuading the legislature of the wisdom of changing this law.
May I have a motion on accepting the warrants from November to this date?
I would move that we accept the warrants as presented in our packets with no further comment on them.
Second.
All those in favor? It's a 7-0. Our next item is to enter into executive session, but before we do that, any citizens who are here who wish to discuss an item on the agenda, this is your opportunity. Come forward, there being none, we'll move on to item number 88.
Madam Chairman, I move we go into executive session for matters relating to land acquisition and/or disposition.
Second.
All those in favor? That's a 7-0. We probably will not be coming back on television tonight, so I want to take this opportunity to wish to all of you from the town council and the town staff very happy holidays, and we'll see you in 1996.
God bless you, everyone.